Mercy be to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Could you bow your heads with me in a word of prayer? Heavenly gracious Father, as we gather in this place this day, we pray that your Spirit will continue to be upon us, that you will continue to touch us by the power of your Holy Spirit to come to know and live in that faith, to be able to share that faith with others. In your name we ask it. Amen. The word of God that I would like to share with you this day and talk about with you is from Paul's letter to the church of Galatia, our epistle reading for today, but I would like to concentrate starting at verse 6, where Paul talks about how the people of Galatia were starting to abandon the gospel message and talk to them. It's always a joy to come back here and share with you what I said. In fact, it seems kind of strange to be back here today because of the last time I was here. The last time I was here was September 23rd of last fall. And what was interesting about that day was that as I shared with you the gospel message, the next day I was starting a teaching position at Unity Institute. I was teaching sermons, how to do sermons. And so I had a very unique experience last fall and had the opportunity again to teach another class this spring, which ended Thursday. And today I'm preaching here. Now, what makes that unique and intriguing to me is that I did not do any other guest preaching between September and today. And so, gathered here today, kind of you become the bookends on my first year of adjunct instructor at Unity Institute. And we'll talk about that a little bit during the message, some of the things I've learned and shared and then I learned and hopefully taught them too. But one of the things about all that is it talks about the gospel truth. Our sermon title in our bulletin talks about the gospel of truth. Well, I would like to talk about the gospel truth, kind of shorten that down a little bit. And last week, I don't know if any of you caught the article in the Kansas City Star on Saturday in the religion section. There was an interesting article about Pope Francis. Pope Francis that week had done a message in one of his in his chapel at the Vatican, in which he talked about how salvation now was for all people. Now, that sounds great because we talk about that all the time, but if you know anything about Roman Catholicism, and especially the official teachings of Roman Catholicism, that Roman Catholics believe this, that outside the church there is no salvation. In other words, the official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church is that only Roman Catholics are going to be in heaven, because everybody else is not part of the church, the Roman Catholic Church. In other words, they say that Jesus really, in essence, came to die only for Roman Catholics. Now, Pope Francis is saying that Jesus came to die for everyone, which is a teaching that we and most Protestants espouse and proclaim. And so all of a sudden now the gospel of truth, or the gospel truth, may be changing for the Roman Catholic Church. So what is the gospel truth? If you look it up in dictionary.com, it says it's something that's unquestionably true. Something that is unmistakably what we believe and what we teach. So what is the gospel truth? Well, first of all, let's look at that word gospel. The word gospel is a very interesting word. As I shared with you in the children's talk, it is evangelion, which means the good news, the gospel, the saving message. It could be a lot of different things of how we work it. And as the angels proclaimed that message, as I said, it was always good news. For Paul, it is the heart and soul of what he believes and what he teaches. For Paul, it was the heart and soul of how his life had been turned around, changed. Paul is talking to people, excuse me, in Galatia as they struggle with the gospel truth. Paul says, don't you remember the gospel message that I shared with you? gospel message that was shared with you. If most of us really rethink about that, we have to go back to the first time we heard the gospel message. For many of us, that was John 3:16, early years of Sunday school. We were taught the gospel in a nutshell. For God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. The gospel, the good news. Paul says it is power that touches our lives. In Romans 1:16, he said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power unto salvation, to be saved, to believe. Paul says it is mighty, it's powerful, it can do great things for you. The gospel, that is that message that talks about Jesus and the truths that he proclaimed. It's interesting, the good news, the gospel. Throughout this last year, it has been interesting to me to hear about the good news. As I have listened to messages, and probably one of the most interesting things about listening to messages is that the majority of my students were women. And so I had to learn and change in how I listen to people as they speak. But they shared about the message of Jesus in a different way. Not that they said that Jesus wasn't their Savior, but what did Jesus really mean to them? Now, there were times that as they spoke, I didn't agree with what they were saying. But my job was not to agree with their theology. My task was to teach them how to speak, to be preachers. And yet, they typified what the world is struggling with. They typified with what does Jesus really mean to people in their lives today. You know, if you grew up Lutheran like I did, born and raised and always been a Lutheran, the message of Jesus was pretty clear. The salvation plan was laid out very early in my life. I've lived and believed that and proclaimed that through for all my life. And yet, as I live in a world, and we live in a world today, it's a lot different. If you ask people what the gospel is, many of them can't tell you what it is. You ask them who Jesus is. They can tell you a little bit about Jesus, but what does it really mean to them? You ask them what the gospel truth is, and some people don't have the foggiest idea what you're saying to them. So what is this gospel truth? For us, who believe that God's word is God's word, the gospel truth is very simple. It's the good news of Jesus Christ who came to be our Savior. It is that message of salvation that Paul proclaimed. It's that message in John 3:16 that shares with us the need that we have for a Savior. Someone who came, lived among us, died on a cross for us, and rose victorious on Easter morning. That's the gospel truth. That's the truth that shares with us that Jesus is the Savior of the world, the good news of all mankind. But why and what does that truth really mean to us in our lives? Why do we need to know that truth? Why did Jesus have to be our Savior? It's interesting how the world looks at that need. For some, it's a need that I just may not live my life the way I really live it. For us, we like to talk about what sin is. We like to talk about what sin does to us in our lives. We like to talk about how the Bible talks about sin is doing anything that is against God's laws. You know, there's many ways we break God's laws. Some of it we do intentionally. You know, I always like to describe it as we draw a line in the sand, and for some of us, we like to sneak up and just kind of go over that line. And then there's sometimes when we like to take a long running preparation to leap over that line. And there are times I don't even know I'm doing sin. And yet there are times that by my very nature, I am a sinner. I was born in sin. Sometimes when I get into discussion with people about sin and the impact it has on their lives, we get into that discussion, well, sin isn't really a part of our lives, and why do people die? If you believe that in Romans, Paul says the wages of sin is death, then sin must cause death. For some people, they don't look at sin that way. They look at sin as an error in what I have done, an error in judgment. And sometimes it's an error in judgment that comes from the outside that impacts me in my life. But we believe it the other way around. We believe that that error, that sin is on the inside. By very nature, we are born that way. And it works its way out. People say, well, that's not true. And I said, well, let me ask you this question. Why is there hate in the world? Why is it that people devalue lives of others? Why is it that there's no peace in the world? What causes that? Come on, tell me what truth causes that. The truth is that by nature, sin exists. Paul knew that. Paul proclaimed that. Paul shared that. Paul also shared the gospel message. And he talked about the importance of that gospel message, the gospel truth of the people of Galatia. Now, what was happening in Galatia that Paul's writing this letter? What was happening is Paul had been there and ministered to these people, shared with them the gospel message, the truth of salvation. They've come to believe it, they come to live in it, and along came these other people that had a strong Jewish background, Jewish Christian background. And they were trying to get the people of Galatia to turn their lives around in the sense that in order for them to truly be Christians, they had to follow the Jewish laws. They had to eat certain foods. They had to do certain rituals, and this is the way they had to be. Paul said, that's not the gospel message. That's not the true gospel message. Paul points out to that relationship that he had with Jesus Christ. He talks about that relationship with Jesus Christ that changed his life around, and that had changed their lives around. And that they weren't to abandon that gospel truth. Because that relationship with Jesus is so important. Isn't it interesting how important relationships are? How in our lives, in our world today, we talk a lot about relationships. We talk about how important they are. And there's one key word that I found through the years of ministry and pastoring that is the heart and soul of relationships. It's the word trust. If there is a lack of trust in a relationship, there's usually a very, very poor relationship. If there's a strong trust factor and a strong trust in that relationship, you find a very, very strong relationship. Isn't it interesting that the more truthful we are, the more we live and share the truth, the better off we are in life? When I taught confirmation, one of the things I used to always share with the confirmants was, I said, I'm going to give you some advice growing up. I gave a lot of free advice. That's one of the things you can do is be a pastor. And one of them was, I said, whatever you do, tell the truth. Even if you are in trouble, tell the truth, because you'll get in less trouble if you tell the truth than if you keep telling lies. You know the trouble with telling lies is you don't remember what you said. You've got to keep making up more lies because you can't remember what the truth you told was. Or if you come home and you say, this is what I did, I'm ready for my punishment, you're still going to get punished, but probably not as severe as when you don't tell the truth. And in life, that happens so much. In life, sometimes it's hard to really discern, to figure out who is really telling us the truth. Remember the story of Jesus, his crucifixion account? When he's on trial, Jesus talks that he had come to share the truth and be the truth. And Pilate asks that simple question, what is truth? What is truth? What is that truth of Jesus Christ? And why is the truth of the gospel, the great message of Jesus, his life, his death, his Easter victory over the grave, so important to us? Why does the cross mean so much to us? Why do his promises mean so much? Why is our faith such a vital part of who we are and what we are? That really is what the gospel truth is all about. It's all about knowing and living in the promises of God, the faith of Jesus, his Son, and the truth that his Word shares with us. Throughout this last year, there were times that I heard different truths proclaimed. And even though I didn't agree with them, I found myself becoming stronger in the gospel truths that I live and believed in. So the gospel truth became for me who I am and what I am. And through this study for this text, for this message this day, I was drawn back to a song. And I like contemporary Christian music. I'm old, so I listen to older Christian contemporary music. But one of my favorite songs is a group, one of my favorite groups is Phillips, Craig, and Dean. And in the 90s, this is how old the song is, in the 90s, there was a song they shared. It was called Where It Has Always Been. And somehow in this preparation for this text and thinking about this the last couple of weeks, I was being drawn back to that song. And then I hear it on the radio, it was like God was saying, and then it was time for you to listen to the song. And I'd like to share with you the chorus, because this is what the voice for me helps remind me of God's great truths in our lives. It says, the power is still where it's always been. His word is alive. Jesus still lives. The power of his blood hasn't lessened or dimmed. It's where it's always been. It's where it's always been. The gospel truth has always been there. What does that gospel truth mean to you? In Jesus' name, amen. And now the peace of God, which is beyond all human comprehension and understanding, we keep our hearts and minds fixed on his cross and on his great love and his great power to know that we live and can share that gospel of truth. In his name, amen. I invite you to now rise and join with me as we profess this gospel of truth that we have lived.